या कुंदेन तुषार हार धवला, या शुभ वस्त्रा बता, या वीणा वर दंड मंडित करा, या श्वेत पद्मासना, या ब्रह्मा चतुर शंकर प्रभृति भृदेव सदा वंदिता, सा माम पातु सरस्वती भगवती निशेष जाड्यापा। जो कुंद के फूल चंद्रमा और बर्फ के हार के समान श्वेत है, जो श्वेत वस्त्र पहनती है, जो हाथों में वीणा धारण किए है और श्वेत कमलों के आसन पर विराजमान है, ब्रह्मा विष्णु महेश आदि देवता जिनकी सदा स्तुति करते हैं, जो हर प्रकार की जड़ता हर लेती है, वह सरस्वती हम सभी का उद्धार करे। नमस्कार। ए वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। दी डायरेक्टरेट ऑफ स्टूडेंट वेलफेयर महाराणा प्रताप यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर एंड टेक्नोलॉजी उदयपुर एक्सटेंड्स ए वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ यू इन दी महाराणा प्रताप मेमोरियल लेक्चर 2020. It's a matter of honor for MPUAT that Padma Bhushan Dr. Rajendra Singh Baroda, former secretary there and director general ICAR, a great researcher and an able administrator of the domain of agriculture, has joined us to deliberate on the crucial issue of the ways and means of bringing youth to the mainstream of agriculture. Sir, from the historic lane of Mewat, we extend a very warm welcome to you in this webinar, which has been organized to commemorate great Maharana Pratap. Ladies and gentlemen, the occasion is graced by Honorable Vice Chancellor of NPUAT, Dr. Narendra Singh Rathore, as chairman of the session. We extend a sincere welcome to the esteemed Vice Chancellor. We welcome all the Vice Chancellors and dignitaries from all over the country who have joined us in this prestigious event. We extend reception to all the deans, directors, senior colleagues from various parts of the country in this webinar. And at the outset, we request our student welfare officer, Dr. Deepak Sharma, for the welcome address. Dr. Deepak Sharma, please.
दीपक शर्मा सर, कल्पना मैडम के बैठे, प्लीज आप बोलना शुरू करें सर, अनम्यूट करें सर अपने आप को।
नमस्कार, गुड मॉर्निंग, मायसेल्फ दीपक शर्मा। इट्स इंडीड अ ग्रेट ऑनर एंड प्रिविलेज फॉर मी एज एन ऑर्गेनाइजिंग सेक्रेटरी टू गेट दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी ऑफ एक्सटेंडिंग ग्रेटिट्यूड एंड वार्म वेलकम all on behalf of Directorate of Student Welfare and PUAT in this very prestigious and notable event, Maharana Pratap Memorial Lecture 2020. I am much more delighted and overjoyed to welcome a legendary, illustrious and acclaimed personality, former Secretary there and DG ICAR, founder chairman of CAS, Trust for Advancement of Agricultural Sciences, an administrator and decorated with the country's prestigious Padma Bhushan Award, as a scholar, researcher and administrator, one who has notably contributed to establishing secure food resources for the world's most densely populated areas. His visionary leadership has ensured a global focus on one of humanity's oldest problems, educate food for all. Most respected Dr. R.S. Baroda sir, for his very humble presence to deliver today's lecture on the topic Maya, an opportunity for youth in agriculture. Sir, on behalf of all the participants, agriculture fraternity across the country, kindly accept our hearty greetings, education and warm welcome. It's indeed a very blissful day for all of us to have your gracious presence to deliver Maharana Pratap Memorial Lecture this morning. A leader is one whose actions inspire others to dream more, run more, do more and become more. and so is the leadership quality of our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Karimishu Nathur. He is one who provides vision, inspires and motivates, and works as an effective role model. Dr. Nathur has eventually conceptualized today's event, guided us to plan and formulate it. I welcome you, sir, on behalf of all present in this online special lecture series. I extend a hearty welcome to all the respected Vice Chancellors who have joined this event speech from various universities, deans, directors and officials of Honorable Government Institute of Agriculture and Technology, as well as other universities, teachers, scientists, students and researchers from the community and other institutions in large number. Hearty welcome to all head of the departments, members of senior officers, Council of the community, Minister Madam, Controller Sir, other dignitaries, members of organizing committee, Inspector Dr. Venkate Palyaji, Deputy Dr. Vice Chancellor, Dr. Nadeem Chaudhary, Professor at the Department of Science and Engineering, Dr. S.K. Sharma, Honorable Director of Professor Economy, and Engineer Manjeet Singh. I also extend a warm welcome to Dr. Rajesh Sharma, Team CTA and Coordinator IDP, and officials of IDP, as well as all others who have joined this webinar. Once again, welcome to all and you all.
Session. Our Honorable Vice Chancellor shall chair the assembly today. Though Honorable Vice Chancellor Dr. N.S. Nathur is well known as far and wide, yet it's my pleasant duty to introduce to him. Our worthy Vice Chancellor Dr. Narendra Singh Nathur is having 38 years of professional experience behind him. That includes various administrative positions like Deputy Director General Agricultural Education and Engineering in ICR, and as founder Vice Chancellor of SKNAU Jodhpur. His contributions as teacher and scientist and various administrative capabilities has been enormous. He has served as chairman or as member of various boards and committees. As DGP Education, he was instrumental in several reforms like implementation of 5th Dean Committee's recommendations, launching of Students Ready Program, and National Agricultural Higher Education Project in collaboration with World Bank. As Vice Chancellor of NPUAT, he has brought a number of reforms and has enhanced the visibility of the university as events from massive campaign for online education, signing of MOUs with institutions of repute, high rate of publication and H index of 47. Under his leadership, NPUAT is marching at a rapid pace. Despite being an able administrator, he has shown great character as a teacher and researcher, as evinced from large number of students of his spreading fragrance all over the world and huge number of vivid publications. To have him today as chairman of the session in the presence of luminary Dr. R.S. Parota is our divinely fortune. With great regards, we request Honorable Vice Chancellor Sir to take chair and conduct the event. Dr. Narendra Singh Nathur.
Thank you, Dr. Virendra Nepalyaji. Thank you very much. Good morning to one and all. Esteemed Chief Speaker Padma Bhushan, Sri Dr. R.S. Parota Sahab, our former Secretary here and DG ICR. I take this opportunity to welcome you. Sir, everybody knows about you. There is no need to repeat, but however, today I will take this opportunity to give some of the things which people are not aware. You are a person of visionary, most dynamic. That is my observation with a brief span of 5 years to serve in the ICR. I have seen that the way you have expanded the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, nobody will forget in year to come. You are a person of a full capability and commitment to serve this country. He is a person, and today we are really fortunate that he has given a time to address our all faculty members. Today we are also honored with the presence of a number of a Vice Chancellor, my friend Dr. Parveen Roy from our Hyderabad, Telangana University, and team our Dr. Chakopadhyayji, VC from DCKV, and many of our deans and directors. And today proudly I can say that more than 950 person has joined. for this webinar. Sir, we are really grateful to see you today, and we will definitely be elevated at the end of the day. I also welcome my senior colleagues from MPOT, heads of the department, faculty, scientists, even few scholar, MSc and PhD students, they have also approached me. And then I have requested Dr. Naveen Chaudhary to allow their entry as well. All distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I take this opportunity to welcome all of you. It is a really a great pleasure for me to say that a son of the soil of Rajasthan is with us. And we are really proud to say that he did his master degree from our MPU team. Earlier it was the Sukhadia University and Udaipur University. So we always feel ourselves elevated whenever we came across that Dr. Baroda has done this and he has initiated this activity. Proudly we are saying that he is a man from this of our place. Although he did his PhD and other work from a different places, but we feel ourselves pleasure that and today he has accepted our request to deliver the prestigious Mahana Pratap Memorial Lecture 2020. Although we are celebrating 480th birth anniversary of Mahana Pratap, and it was there on 25th May 2020, but because of this COVID-19, we could not celebrate it. I still remember when the day when Dr. Deepak Sharma, our student welfare officer, came to me and then asked that to whom we should invite. Immediately, I thought that let us take the chance. We were not fully confident that whether Honorable Sir will spare a time for this small university, but I am really thankful to you, Sir, that you have accepted our proposal. And today, we basically, many of our senior citizens from Udaipur, they have also joined our webinar. And because Mahana Pratap was not a simple man who has been recognized for his symbol of courage and bravery and self-respect and patriotism, but he was himself an instrument, a complete institute, rather I can say. And he has done a lot of miracles if you will go to history. And recently there was some problem in some of the our primary school literature, which when came to notice of our Honorable Chief Minister, immediately he said, when few of group members met him in Jaipur, he was a person, he said that Mahana Pratap is not a representative of any single caste, it is a representative of a whole of Rajasthan, and we are proud of that he is from our state, and we will definitely maintain the right type of harmony to sensitize each and every group of a society about Mahana Pratap, because Mahana Pratap has got a lot of good quality apart from a bravery and courage. And everybody knows that when Akbar has offered him that kindly accept our proposal and be a part of Akbar regime, and we will provide you the identity of to serve the 50% of this nation. But he refused. He said that my prime responsibility is to serve the Mewar. And as a result of this, he was always ready to fight with all this type of anti-social element. Here I would like to mention there are few qualities of Mahana Pratap which we should articulate in our day-to-day life. Very important thing is a mental focus. His focus was only for getting independence. And and proudly I can say there are few qualities of Mahana Pratap which I can see resemblance to our speaker Padam Bhushan Dr. R.S. Baroda Sahab as well. His mental focus is always towards the development of agriculture. I have gone through with a policy paper which he has published for Haryana and Rajasthan. I am equally elevated to see that he not only for a research and extension, he is given a right space for a education, capacity building, training, consultancy, testing, and each and everything he has covered. And he has given an idea that how we can expand the field, how we can create a right type of visibility of agriculture in our state. So as far as the mental focus is concerned, perhaps this is a quality we should adopt in day-to-day our activity. Second important quality of Mahana Pratap was a physical energy. Everybody knows that he was always keeping 80 kg of a shroud and 80 kg of metallic cover on his body. And more than that, if you see the weight of head and other thing, around 210 kg he was always keeping with him during in the battle or outside of the battle even, and whereas his own weight was 110 kg. So that type of physical energy is here. He was maintaining, and we are really fortunate that Dr. Baroda Saab, after retirement even, and I pray with the board, kindly give him a long life and a happy life. And as a person, when he is always proactively helping each and every stakeholder, I am sure that he will be having a very long life to serve this country. And second thing is that a personal willpower. I have observed that when our ASRB was almost in the stage of diffusing. At that stage, a restructuring work was offered by the government of India, and very nicely, very systematically, structure-wise, he has seen that what type of transparency, what type of effectiveness, what type of fairness, what type of objectivity, and what type of our activity we supposed to have. There are a lot of things are there in the support of our esteemed Padma Bhushan Sri R.S. Baroda Saab. And not only the original talent he was having, he is brought up from our Rajasthan too, by all fellow scientists, those who are from Rajasthan. Let us see, when I worked in the Krishi Vigyan Kendra Ajmer, we used to passing through the Sardana, his own native village. And we used to be always saying that Dr. Baroda, at the time he was working as a director general. And we always saying, and any person, all person working in the Krishi Vigyan Kendra Lohagal and Ajmer, they were proud of that our director general was from our place. And one important thing which I have observed, and with most of the, our colleagues from the TAS and other person, especially Dr. Bhagmal and other person, they have mentioned, that daily he is sparing some of the time for the this type of academic work. And that's why that type of ability we are supposed to have. Today, we are really fortunate that he has accepted our request, and today he is delivering an important lecture in the memory of a Mahana Pratap. And I think everybody knows there is no need to introduce Dr. Baroda Saab, but I take this opportunity to introduce him, and everybody knows him that what is his contribution. And today, as I have mentioned, that he will be delivering a new word so called Maya. Earlier it was Arya, attracting and retaining youth in agriculture. But very interestingly and very peacefully, he has mentioned that before attraction, it should be motivation. And motivating and then attracting youth in agriculture, that is a need of our. So everybody knows his dynamism, leadership in agriculture. And as I mentioned that he born in our Ajmer, Rajasthan in 1942. And he is an alumnus of our university, MSc from a very important college, Rajasthan College of Agriculture. Earlier, this was the only college in the Rajasthan. And later on, a different college in a job near another college got an identity. He did a PhD from IARI and postdoctorate fellow from the College of Wales from a UK. And he occupied the prime position of secretary there and Government of India and Director General of ICAR from 1992 to 2001. And prior to this, he was Director of National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources, New Delhi. He was Deputy Director General of Crop Science, and during this period a lot of new visibility in the field of crop science came into the picture, and he was instrumental behind a lot of expansion of ICAR. And perhaps he is the only person who has really earned heat and everything because of his quality. He rose to the chair of Global Forum of Agriculture Research, and he was an architect, as I mentioned at initial inception. He was architect of the world's largest and most modern national gene bank of NPGR in New Delhi. And if we, everybody from, whether he is working in Gujarat or Rajasthan or any place in the India in the field of agriculture, everybody used to go to the NAS campus. And NAS campus, in fact, it is the vision of Dr. Baroda, and he has made a lot of flexibility and lot of the scope of improvement, and that the way, in case if you enter inside of it, you will feel that every comfort aspect was given, and an impressive NSC campus, no doubt. it will not be repeated in future as well, that I can say, because that the way he has done, and minutely, that is interesting thing, minutely he has observed each and everything while the construction of a accommodation of a DDGs and Director General, he personally supervised each and everything. That is the way how we can have that type of a quality in our mindset as well. And in the recognition of his outstanding contribution in the field of genetic resource management, ICRISET and Agriculture Research Institute of Kazakhstan, they have named the gene bank after the Dr. Raj Karoda Sahab. And he was most prestigious recipient of a Padma Bhushan Award presented by President of India in 1998. And apart from this, he was having a lot of awards, and the list is very long, but to brief, I can say Rafi Ahmed Pippai Award, ICR Team Research Award, Fikki Award, Om Prakash Bhasin Award, Asia Pacific Seed Association Award, Lifetime Achievement Award by Association of Agriculture Scientists in America, and gold medal from Ministry of Agriculture of Armenia and Ministry of Agriculture Vietnam, Lifetime Achievement Award of Agriculture Today, Dr. A.B. Jyoti Memorial Award, Professor Kanyan Memorial Award. The list is very long. In case people, I will start, then I will take the time of our chief guest as well. So, to brief, I can say that he has been confirmed with a fellow of most National Science Academic like INSA, NAS, NA, NASI. They are lot of any good credit to his overall personality. He was elected as a fellow of Agriculture Academies of Russia, Georgia, and even the Third World Academy of Science. He was president for more than dozen for Agriculture Scientific Society in India, American Society of America, Agronomy and Crop Science Society of America. They have also awarded prestigious honorary membership in 2001 to Dr. Karoda. And he was conferred with more than 17 academic institutes and universities honorary degree. And we also feel proud that he has accepted our proposal in 2003 in a second convocation of MPUC. Our university feel proud to award the honorary degree of a Doctor of Science to Dr. Karoda. And he has accepted, and I can say that he is having a top corner for our university, and I pray with God that wherever he will go, he will definitely help to for the development of MPUT. Because if you see the history, he was instrumental in establishing a global forum of agriculture research in FAO Rome, and same way APARI. I remember I got an opportunity to have a interaction with Dr. Bhagmal in a very first APARI meeting, which was held in Taiwan. Then I came to know, and he was always a spokesperson for Dr. Karoda, and he mentioned lot of good quality. Time is short, that's why I am not in position to narrate each and everything, but he was the first Indian to serve as a chairman of ICRISET Board of Trustees. And he was a board of trustee of ERI. He was a member of a WMO high level task force on climate services, and he has successfully organized number of international conferences like Crop Science Conference in 1996, Most Prestigious Indian Science Congress in 2001, and a Global Conference on Women in Agriculture in 2012, Agriculture Science Congress in 1997 and 1999. And under his direction, state agriculture policies, as I mentioned. And we are always looking and getting a right type of information. It is a type of a document, and rather I can say it is a type of an encyclopedia. Everybody should go through it critically by one. Then we will understand that how we can expand agriculture scenario in our Rajasthan. There are a lot of things are there to his credit, but he is a strong believer of a youth in our country. And in a young India where more than 57% of population is below 30 years, they are also eager to have that somebody should be there in the top level who can lead them and who can give them the right direction. That is the reason that always he is a spokesperson, that if we are supposed to convert the Arya into Maya, and we are supposed to do lot of changes as far as the motivating of this youth is concerned. At present, our country is facing a lot of problems. not only the before COVID, even International Monetary Fund has mentioned that 31% of youth inequity is there. That is, that gives an impression that a youth of around more than 75 crore and 31% of these people are not having any opportunity to have a school, college and livelihood. And that's why there is a need to have some agri-entrepreneurship. And in the post-COVID scenario, when everybody is thinking about the post-entrepreneurship, perhaps his direction and his vision in this field will be useful to our students. And presently, everybody knows he is a chairman of a task trust for advancement of agriculture science, and his global goal during the last two decades has been to link to science with society. We extend a majestic welcome to such a big person of a vision, dynamism, and outstanding capability. And we sincerely request that at least motivate our student and give a right sense of humor in the mindset of our scientists so that they will feel and they will have a right type of faith and trust in the system. And definitely when the right faith will be there, I am sure that we will be having a right hope for our future. With this word, once again, I welcome our Padam Bhushan Dr. Paroda Sahab, and with a request to kindly enlighten us on the concept of Maya. And more than, as I mentioned, that today it was overwhelmed more than that of a 950 plus audience are eagerly waiting to hear your address. With this word, thank you very much and thanks a lot. And now I request you, sir, kindly take this platform and address our all scientific community and students and other persons attached with this webinar. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Rathore, for these very generous remarks and introduction. I could not say no when you asked me to speak today. As you rightly said, being alumnus of the university which you are now heading, it's a great privilege for me and to you, to all other participants, Honorable Vice Chancellor, and the deans and directors of the university, I really consider it a privilege to interact with the students, especially on a subject which is of considerable relevance in today's context. I was pleasantly surprised when you asked me that I should speak on Maya, and then the constraint I had was that I have come under COVID-19 pandemic situation to my hometown, so I am speaking from my village to all of you, and this shows that even despite the kind of constraints you may have, you can now learn through the opportunities of ICT to interact globally. The only other day we had launch of ISPRI for the World Food Policy Report, and that was also done while being here. So, world has become small. The revolutions in science have made it possible to interact and think more differently than what we had been doing in the past. Linking my lecture to Honorable Maharana Pratap during his, Jayanti, I consider it as a double privilege. I always admired. I had been in Udaipur for 2 years doing my master's, and whenever would go to Maharana Pratap statue and the circle, It used to inspire us that, see, what a man of determination, a man who could fight against all odds and could not only despite defeat get all his kingdom back from the person like Akbar at that time, who was otherwise winning all other rulers around the world, around the country. that respect, I would like to say that best message for our youth would be that be a fighter, must have determination, must learn to achieve your goals despite the defeat, even if you come through, and must be able to take risks. My topic today for deliberation is Maya, about which Dr. Rathore so elaborately explained, that this should be taken as an opportunity for youth to do something more in agriculture than what they have accomplished so far. And in that respect, next slide please. As I said, let's pay our homage to Maharana Pratap, who almost 480 years ago demonstrated to the rest of the world, hunt and fight for the cause and for freedom. And freedom is the basic for any progress and growth. And that's what he tried to accomplish and achieve. And he lived with great honor and was never captured by Akbar despite all the efforts that he made. Next one. Maharana Pratap, as has been already said, he was the ruler of Mewar. He fought against Mughals. The famous Haldi Ghati ki ladai is known, and we are aware of. Now, let's see about the agriculture. Agriculture, we have been telling all through, jab se hum krishi mein rahe hain, aaye hain, saikdo saalon se Bharat ek krishi pradhan desh raha hai, par humne kabhi bhi hai wo krishi pradhan nahi, krishak ko pradhan nahi banaya, and that is what is needed in this context. Farmer first. And farmer first is only possible when the aging farming population is helped by the youth and embracing agriculture as their profession. Next. So, Maya is motivating and attracting youth in agriculture. You cannot just ask somebody to be attracted. When I was the chairman of Haryana Farmers Commission and talking to the progressive farmers, asked them what do they want and what are their needs, they said, sir, our main problem is that our young generation is not interested in agriculture. Could something be done to see that they do not move out of agriculture? And that, I think, we started looking more seriously. And notice that you cannot just attract youth by telling that you be in this profession unless they have any kind of motivation. And that motivation can only come by efforts of the kind that I am going to talk about next. And previous one. And when we say about doing anything in any profession, we have to say that we must be globally wise, but we must act locally. So even for Maya way forward, what we have to see is that we must see what is happening at global level, but we must then try to translate all those successes which are achieved elsewhere to our local situation. Next please. India has done well. When I was doing my post PhD at IRI, the seeds of Green Revolution were being sown, and we didn't have Green Revolution that time. And from that status, now we have made great strides, not only in green, but also through White Revolution, Golden Revolution, that is through agricultural development, and then blue, and from nowhere, in terms of production, from less than 1 million ton, we are now more than 15 million ton. And in case of fruits, the production of fruits has excelled now that of food grains, and for the last 5 years we are having more horticulture production than the production of food grains, which is around 295 million tons. And the milk, we have almost, you know, from less than 20 million tons now come to almost 200 million tons. Next one. So there had been impacts of these revolutions from status of begging bowl. Now we could meet our food demand, increase the food by sixfold, horticulture production also by many folds. We could reduce poverty from 70 to almost 20%. We have now buffer stock, which not many countries in the world have, and the COVID-19 has clearly demonstrated that in future we will require better food systems to have immunity and good health to combat this pandemic. Otherwise, there will be difficulties and much more problems with the people around the world. And the food must be available, but food, if it is not transported and made available, recently we came out with an open letter to the UN and also G20, in which many Nobel laureates, also the Padma awardees, World Food laureates from India had also signed, including Dr. Swaminathan, that you would require the availability of food as a first requirement to combat any kind of pandemic, including COVID-19. So buffer stock, which we have to the extent of now 50 to 70 million tons ranging in last decade, is a great strength. We have now become a major exporter, almost $40 billion worth export being made, and then we have recorded production only this year for food grain, rice, wheat, maize, oilseeds and cotton. Next one. So when we look at this, it is not just that we only had miracle wheat seeds or rice seeds which made this difference. Thanks to the policy makers, that they provided support for building infrastructure, and there was capital investment in agriculture, which was to the extent of about 16 to 18% during Green Revolution time, which has now come down to by almost half, around 8 to 9%. So these are the issues, but though the area for cultivation has remained static at around 140 for last 5 decades, but the crop intensity has increased the gross crop area to 198% or almost 200%. Net irrigated area has doubled, gross irrigated area has tripled, and with no coverage under improved varieties and hybrids till almost 70, now we have got almost 60 to 70% coverage under improved varieties. And fertilizer, with no fertilizer use, around 70 when Green Revolution started, now we have the fertilizer used to the extent of almost 25 to 27 million tons. These are all remarkable, support systems that we had, which led to all these successes in the past. Next one. So when we now look at, over the years, we have on one side addressed our concerns for food and nutrition security, but on the other side, it is being now realized that we have overexploited our natural resources. Factor productivity decline is now reflected, decline in soil health and water table, and especially in Rajasthan, we have a problem of water scarcity. There is macronutrient imbalance and micronutrient deficiency. Increased incidence of diseases and pests is there. Also, we have now realized that farmers are not able to have more income because of costly inputs, more costly labor, costly electricity, costly fertilizers, and above all, we are now finding that possibly a message is going among the policy makers of complacency that we have enough and we have done more, so maybe we can go back to organic farming and take care of our natural resources more aggressively. Next one. So challenges before youth when we look at and why they are not attracted towards agriculture is because firstly there is lack of good knowledge that they are able to get. There is also limited access to land. Land holdings are invariably small. Financial resources are a constraint. We need credit at a reasonable interest, but invariably the interest rates are very high otherwise. Difficulties in linking farmer directly to market, and that's where youth can play a great role, and probably youth doesn't have any role in decision making, be it at house level or be it at institution level or be it at national level. Poor social image of agriculture. When I took agriculture as a profession and joined agriculture college at that time in Ajmer, Dayanand College, my class fellows all laughed at me that you should have gone either to medical or engineering, which all bright students go, but what is there in agriculture? I can tell you, agriculture, I have never had any regret having taken that subject, though I never thought at that time that I will be a scientist or go to achieve newer heights, but thought that agriculture, if you study, would try to do differently on your own farm than otherwise what we are doing, and that's what I am going to again speak later. And there exists also an aspirational and attainment gap. When I used to talk to youth, and still I am having a lot of conferences and interact with them, often they say, sir, we are willing to be entrepreneur and embrace agriculture, but would we be able to send our children to same schools to which you had sent your children? I think that's the aspiration, and to attain that aspiration and to bridge that gap, what we need is proper hand-holding. Hand-holding by the teacher, by the institution, and we need mentors who are successful farmers or entrepreneurs who can give their experiences to others, and we need funding support. Next one. So, in that respect, when now we think with this background and take the context of Rajasthan, I would like to say that we really are again, no doubt, in a state which is unique in many ways, faced with many challenges, but we also have a lot of opportunities. And that's what I am going to first talk about, because this lecture is for youth in agriculture, mainly in Rajasthan, where we are talking today. Rajasthan is unique in many ways, not only for its valor, old culture about which we talk, or traditions, or for its food, but also for its rich biodiversity. Be those men and women, be those animals, be those also the biodiversity, plants, and also whether grasses and trees. And it is the largest state in the country. Geographical area is almost 10%, and nearly 65% of the population. And the rest of the country is around 50 to 55% population is dependent on agriculture. But in Rajasthan, we have majority of population depending still on agriculture, and almost out of say 8 crores of people and roughly about 6 crore of animal population. Nowhere you will find, despite being the desert state, so much of animal intensity per square kilometer that you have here. And we have the fortunate situation of also having about 10 million rural youth, including women, and those are in fact our strength, which can, next one, could further be exploited in the right direction. Challenges are, we have harsh climate, we have frequent droughts, we have almost 1 year, a drought year among 3 years, very low rainfall, half of the state is less than 300 millimeters, and poor soil health, and organic matter content is very poor, and our productivity levels also therefore are low. When we, please, next one. So when we look at as to what is needed, then obviously we need to increase our crop yields and increase income of the farmers. We have to improve soil health by improving nutrient use efficiency, by going in for different ways of improving soil health, by conservation agriculture, by going in for carbon sequestration and so on, water harvesting, water use efficiency. The Prime Minister So we have to go in for water harvesting. Dr. Nazir Ahmed, Dr. Amisha Sharma, kindly mute yourself, please. And appreciate it. We need also, because of the arid agriculture, we need timely operation and farm mechanization and good agronomic practices. We would also require diversification of agriculture. Can't live only bajra and moat, but we have to think of having different crops and commodities, horticulture, dairy, poultry, fishery, even agroforestry has to play very significant role in Rajasthan, and post-harvest processing and value addition. So the issue now is not only of producing more, but also whatever we produce, how to process it and value add it and then market it is another challenge and option before us. So let us now think in, next one please. Next one. So look at the unique opportunities. We have great diversity. Crops, you don't find these kinds of, diversity in rest of the world. I have visited most of the desert and never seen such kind of vibrant desert that we have in the context of whether these are crops. I don't have more time to go into all these details. You see all listed here, seed spices are grown only in Rajasthan and Gujarat in the dry parts of the our country.
Only in Rajasthan and Gujarat in the dry parts of
our country. Oh, yes. There is an echo now. Fruits, we have beer, amla, anar, cane, and date palm. Medicinal plants, unique grasses. What happened? Then we have got also unique trees. KGD is a wonder tree in the world. Nowhere else you can find such a useful tree. Navinji, can something be done for
I'm trying, sir. I'm trying to mute all, but few people are. I'm not able to.
Then we have unique cattle breed, unique sheep breed, and unique goat breed. And if these breeds have not been there, so support farmers. Possibly farmers in state of Rajasthan would have not survived. It is today because of the animal populations, and therefore we have to equally consider raising them, taking good care of them, and improving their productivity. Next one. Next slide. So there is need for reorientation to profitable and sustainable agriculture through diversification, secondary agriculture, not all dependent on primary agriculture, but what else could be done, whether you can have mushroom production or whether you can have beekeeping or honey production and some of those, and go in for specialty agriculture by growing specialty crops. I will talk about them later. And also we have to think of post-production scenario more effectively. Next one. And in that context, when we look at youth globally, let us first have a global scenario in terms of youth and their empowerment. We see that globally we have about 20% youth population between the age of 10 to 24 years, and India is fortunate in that context to have about 356 million youth, of which about 200 million live in rural areas. And Indian population is expected to remain young compared to even China because of their policy for only one child per family. And other populated country like Indonesia in Asia, and the average age of Indian population today is 30 years as against that of 40 in USA, 45 in Europe, and 47 in Japan. So when we look at it, the young population, if can be motivated and retained in agriculture to do agriculture differently, I'm sure this is going to make all the difference and make our country $5 trillion economy in near future. So, next please. Global and regional initiatives have been there for supporting youth. When I was chairing, about which Dr. Rathore had earlier mentioned, the Global Forum on Agriculture Research for Development, based in FAO Rome, we had organized the international conference, what we call a global conference for agriculture research for development in Delhi, and in 2006, and at that time the first call was given for national forum, international forum for youth, and then we established a platform which is called Young Professional for Agriculture Development, that is YPAD, and this YPAD then was established, which is part of GFAR currently. Then we had organized global conferences in 2010 and 2012 in France and Uruguay, with which I was associated, and we had taken about 150 to 200 youth from all over the world to participate in those conferences and make their impact in terms of what new innovations they really can bring about to make agriculture more profitable. And then regional workshops were also organized in Asia Pacific. We had organized one conference in Islamabad through APARI. APARI is the Asia Pacific Association for Agricultural Research Institution, which was established almost 25 years ago, and has done remarkably well to bring all agricultural institutions together. Next one. So when we see that new institutions are needed to support the youth, like YPOD. Then in India, when we organize next one, our national conference, next slide please. We organized the national conference. That time Dr. Appan was the Director General, and in 2013, TAS and APARI and ICR jointly, and the recommendation was that we need to attract youth in agriculture. So ARIA call was there, and ARIA program was initiated, and then we had regional conference again organized for youth in 2018. Which was inaugurated by the then agriculture minister, and it was then realized that we have to think of motivating more rather than simply talking of attracting them. And then after that, as Dr. Praveen Rao is also participating in this conference, we had organized regional youth conferences, one in South with his support at Hyderabad, which was attended by more than about 800 young professionals and students, and then journal conference also in Ludhiana with Dr. Dhillon's support, where about 500 young agriculture farmers and scientists and the students participated. Next one. And very good recommendations have come. Now we see that there are initiatives, government initiative on youth, ARIA, we have talked already. Now there is a student ready initiative. During my time with the ICR, we realized that the students were not getting exposed to students for rural area exposure. And therefore we started the RAVI program, the Rural Entrepreneurship Awareness Development
Rural Entrepreneurship
of the Rural Development started in 2015 to reinforce the RAVI program
in 2015.
And that's where we are providing the RAVI program. And that's where we are providing. There is ECO, Dr. Naveen.
There is ECO.
And look for it. And then we have the Stand Up India program. Then we have National Next one. There is Make in India initiative, Skill India mission, Pradhan Mantri Social Vikas Yojana, then Yuva program. All these are new initiatives through which our youth can get benefited. But they have to understand what are the opportunities, what are the offers provided in these programs, and they have to look at the website of these various ministries.
The website of these various ministries.
Next one. So all these conferences which we had, like farmer-led innovation, Maya conference at national level, and Maya roadmap, these all are available.
Maya roadmap
on task website.
These all are available.
Okay.
Task website.
Considerable eco.
Okay.
Dr. Naveen put something. I think we have to really perfect still this as well. So there is to be really perfect some experiences of this kind which will help us to improve. But good thing is that we are talking and we are able to express our views through national level. Yes, please. That's all. So motivating and attracting youth in agriculture, what is motivating all about? We want to be youth to be job creators,
all about
job seekers. Youth including women as extension agents.
Future to be a paid extension.
Youth also as entrepreneur.
So
why not so the, why not the important role and also yes. They must think in terms of establishing agri clinic, think in terms like we have polyclinic for medical sciences and medical help to the people for agriculture and for the diseases, pests, the nutrition and plant nutrients, knowledge for fertigation, all can be provided through the agri clinic concept where you have more trained entrepreneurs to provide knowledge to the farmers. Next one. Next, please. Scaling innovation, therefore, is very important, and we need to lay greater emphasis now not only on research for publication, but research for innovation. And innovation of the kind which are disruptive, which can give more from less. And like ICT, today you have a smartphone, and today, like sitting here, I can switch on the tube well when I want water on my farm, and that app can be installed by a rural youth. I was really pleasantly surprised that he came when we had installed our new motor, that he gave me the app, and now even I, while sitting in Delhi, can monitor it. So there are options. You need these kinds of innovations, which are not very costly, which are available to the larger community, and by which knowledge can reach to the end user. Next, please. Next one. So we need innovation. Innovations had been there, and they are still there, and much is required to be done. I will come to them again later as well. But hybrid technology, lot of coverage under hybrids can still be possible, because seed replacement is not still more than 50% to 60%. GM crop, soybean, mustard, maize, brinjal, we have not yet utilized except BT cotton. Conservation agriculture, we have not taken advantage of it. Brazil, Argentina, US, Canada, Australia, all have taken benefit of conservation agriculture for their dry land, but in our dry land, we are still having our fields cultivated and keeping them clean, and leading that leads to lot of soil erosion, wind erosion, and what not. Micro irrigation, more area can be brought in. We have to think of improving water use efficiency, which is a major concern. Bioenergy, biofuel, biofortified crop, and also ICT I have mentioned. Next one. So, PT cotton, when it was brought in, we were very clear that it is the technology needed for smallholder farmers. And today, all 95% of area is covered where smallholder farmers are cultivating BT cotton. They are not only increasing their income, but we have become major exporter of cotton in last just 2 decades. And we are also a major country where we have reduced our use of pesticide on cotton by almost 40%. Earlier we used to use 50% of pesticide in agriculture on cotton crop alone. Next one. Conservation agriculture, I have said. Our conservation agriculture is only in rice wheat areas, because we started that program in 1995-96 when I was DDG crop, and only coverage is there, and people are able to then grow now without cultivating the field immediately after rice wheat, and even in standing wheat, planting mung bean, as you see in the slide in the below left, and you can even go in for 2 to 3 crops, but you need this technology, you need access to these equipment, the machinery, zero-till drill, happy seeder, and whatnot. Next one. Protected cultivation. This can increase income of youth by manifold. Even with 1000 square meter covered protected greenhouse, one can easily grow and raise income by easily by 3 to 5 lakhs per annum. So we have sky as a limit, but this we would require not only the structure, it would require the input, it would require the technical services, backstopping for fertigation, for timely operations, for use of pesticides if they are needed, and which seed to be planted at what time. And so when you look at China, China has 2 million hectare area. Our area, despite all efforts we made under NATP over two decades, is still not more than 50,000 hectares. So we have to see as to when we will be able to raise this area to a substantial level. And when the climate is hot, you can grow these vegetables and also the fruit and link yourself to the market to get more income. Next one. Here you have vertical agriculture. Just by, repurposing shipping containers, one can grow the green salad and crops in these greenhouses to the level of almost 2 acres worth of produce. And you are linking yourself directly to market. In Boston, I saw these shipping containers being used for future farming. So there are new options available. Next one. But one need to know, have knowledge. Micro irrigation I talked. Even one can think of subsurface drip irrigation for conservation agriculture in a cropping system like that of rice wheat, which we never thought of, that rice can be grown with subsurface drip system. We thought rice only requires flood irrigation. So there are opportunities, but for that you would require perfect knowledge, you would require entrepreneur, youth to come and embrace, and opportunities for which exist. Next one. Precision farming. I don't think we still have banned the broadcasting of fertilizer. Mostly the farmers go for broadcasting, as you see on the right below left. Why not we use the decision support system and also the soil health card and soil analysis. Even the youth can have soil testing labs and provide better data and information to the farmer and help them to save nutrients and apply only those nutrients which are needed and improve nutrient use efficiency. Our major concern today is of low nutrient use efficiency, not more than 30 to 40%. You can't waste 40 to 60% of nutrients that you otherwise put in the field. So you see above, this is liquid nitrogen being used in US. So there is practically no wastage of use in fertilizer, and your efficiency goes as high as 60 to 70%. Next please. Using ICT in agriculture, youth has all opportunities to provide knowledge to the farmer relating to what he has to plant, what he has to do, and where he has to sell his produce through now national e-marketing system which government is proposing. There are success stories. This is ICT has come out with ICT eChopall as first initiative to provide, and there are now many call centers in various states providing good knowledge to the farmer, and many youth are coming forward and coming up with their app and linking themselves to the market. So they provide knowledge, they also earn, and farmer is benefited equally. Next please. Next, these are all about eChopall. Next, This I am just talking about one entrepreneur. There are many success stories when we had these national conferences on farmer-led innovations and also entrepreneurship. We found that there are several success stories, but these success stories are mainly by entrepreneurs who either were not agriculturists themselves or who were not supported by any institution. But they had a strong will, desire to do something different and took risk, went even abroad, came back with the knowledge and tried to learn and demonstrate, and in the process help the whole village community. There are many examples. Time is not there to express those, but here is one youth who had graduated from Dharwad, went for PhD to USA, started some venture there because he had that desire that I would like to have my own profession, and having learnt biofertilizer and biopesticide, why can't I produce and sell and help farmers to save on the cost which otherwise he needs on costly fertilizer. And but then he came back and he was at Harvard University trying to initiate something, and that time I happened to be there. We encouraged him, and today he is a very successful entrepreneur with the best biofertilizer and biopesticide lab in Bangalore. And in less than decades time, he has an establishment worth almost about 50 crores, as I am told, and hiring more than 100 people, and has too many now patents, more than 15-16 patents, and more than 50 products which he is producing and selling at doorstep of the farmer. He has his own app. He is linking himself, his technology with the farmer, and that's what we want now, the private sector to come forward and ensure that whatever they are producing is available to the end user at his doorstep at the right time. Next one. So there are successes, and in Rajasthan, institutional support fortunately is available. What you need is to go and learn from where? To go to institutions like State Agricultural University. Now we have 5 of them. When I was studying, it was not even one agricultural university. Then the first agricultural university was created in Udaipur, and then now we have 5 ICR institutions in Rajasthan. We have Kajri for arid zone research. We have sheep and wool research institute in Avikanagar for our sheep, and NRC on camel for camel research. But lately, I would say that during those new institutions that were created when I was in the ICR, because I did realize the importance of these institutions. If Rajasthan has to become number one in mustard, it must have its own institution on rapeseed and mustard. So we created the NRC on mustard in Bharatpur. Today, Rajasthan is number one state in mustard production in the country. If we have to move in arid horticulture, then there has to be an institutional base. If we have today green revolution, it is because we had Indian Agriculture Research Institution. So, if it is arid horticulture and we have to move progress, make progress, then National Institute on Arid Horticulture was created at Bikaner. NRC on seed spices. Rajasthan is known for seed spices, but hardly people know about it and are taking benefit, whereas people outside the state are taking more of advantage, like MDH masala is getting all the benefit. But I don't think any entrepreneur from within Rajasthan is trying to take advantage of this. I will talk about it. And then project directorate on Bajra was also shifted at that time to Jodhpur. So fortunately, you have so many institutions, and even 20 years ago, we had seen that Rajasthan was the first state where each district had one KVK. Now, other states have taken more than 20 years after that to have KVK in each of their districts. But Rajasthan has been fortunate for having KVK. Next one, please, on these KVK. So there are options available. There is institution. There are technologies. There is knowledge. One has to go and make sure that there is some person who can hold your hand, maybe a professor, maybe an extension worker, maybe our KVK expert, and most of the technologies that have reached and many of the entrepreneurs which we have come across have been benefited through the KVK in different states of our country. So, whether it is seed production, hybrid seed production, why not hybrid seed production of bajra in Rajasthan itself? Why it should come from outside when 85% of bajra is grown in Rajasthan alone? And why our yield should be so low? Why can't we have 90 to 100% area coverage, 35 nurseries for quality planting? Now I am currently a farmer myself with a small arid horticulture farm, and I can tell you the problem of the farmer is to get right quality of planting material, of whether it is amla or whether it is bear or whether it is chiku or pomegranate, guava, kino, date palm. You need these, and these are not there. So certified, if planting material can be provided, you learn, you earn, and also farmer gain knowledge of through sharing of ICT, paid extension services like protected cultivation. Many have come out with their poly houses, but then failed because they didn't have backstopping, technical backstopping. So it is not only just a structure, but one has to know what is floriculture, what kind of fertigation, what kind of planting and which seed and so on. And that kind of paid extension services now can be, in our village today, in my own home, we used to plant the fields through our own bullocks. But now there are no bullocks available. Mostly the few young farmers with tractors would just on the call come in the morning and do the sowing for your field on custom hire basis. So there are opportunities. When I went to the inauguration of KVK in Padmer, when I talked to the farmers what is their requirement, then they said, sir, you please educate our youth to repair our tractors. So they bought tractors, but the repair services were not available. So you can imagine the options that are today available. Like I told you about having new motor in our well. So when you have motor, sometimes it gets burnt. So from where to get it serviced? Our rewinding can be done right in the village itself. I was surprised, and uneducated youth, but very well trained to do the service. And next day you get rewinded motor again installed in your well. So you have lot of options. Farm mechanization, custom hire services, agri clinics, I have talked, post harvest processing, micro irrigation, contract farming. In case of dairy, we are still only producing milk and giving it to thanks to the mother dairy or Rajasthan dairy or Ajmer dairy, that they are collecting it. But there are not many youth coming as entrepreneurs to establish their own farmer producer organization or company, and start with middle level dairy sector, accredited laboratory for soil and water analysis, or even for organic produce. Rajasthan has great scope for organic farming, but then you would also require someone to certify and test and help you to link to the market. And the biofertilizer, biopesticide, inland fishery, when we have lot of water which is aquaculture, not based, but which has saline water, then we can also go for brackish water aquaculture and go for fishery to a greater extent. And a farmer in Haryana is today the fish seed king for the North India. He started with just 1 acre pond, and today he is leasing ponds in many states, whether in south or even the north, and is linking himself to the market, not in India but abroad. How flower production, including seed of flowers, can be produced, next one. So there are lot of options, and I told you about spices, how much research we have done on them. They are like moat. Is only major crop of Rajasthan. Nowhere else moat otherwise is grown except the desert. But how much research we have on moat, how much research on these spices, whether it is, you know, next one. You see these many crops, next one, that whether jeera, dhania, methi, sauf, ajwain, kalonji, all these are grown and today exported to a large extent from India to global market. And the profit that I could get from Dr. Gopal Lal from his institute, NRC, on seed spices at Tabiji, is tremendous. But where is the knowledge to the farmer? Where is the seed? What is the planting procedure? And how to have value addition? And how to link yourself to the global market, next one. So, major issue now again is the role of youth in marketing. And we need now, unfortunately, through a report which our committee which I headed has given last year to the government, recently the APMC Act has been now done away with, and also Essential Commodity Act has been now done away with, and new Marketing Act at national level has come to have a e-naam system and uniform flow of produce from one state to another without restrictions. Otherwise, you could not go and sell your produce directly to anyone other than going to mandi, and that kind of restrictions are no more required, especially for the crops which are otherwise having you know, lot of losses, post-harvest losses. Next, please. So this committee has given many recommendations. Its recommendations are available on the website. I would request all the vice chancellors and the leaders here to please make it circulated to all the scientists and the students to see as to what are various options, and much of the recommendations for youth and women also have been given in it. Next, please. And for youth, we have recommended that there must be a department of youth in agriculture. Otherwise, we will always talk just for the sake of sympathy towards youth. There must be a national mission on youth. We have to really now, they will change the scene. They will make the agriculture as a respectable profession. Because if they are competent, knowledgeable, have a strong will, they are supported well by institutions, and they have funding support by institutions like also NABARD and other banks, things will change. And why not venture capital by private sector under social corporate responsibility? And why not encourage them to have their agri service centers, and the mission must think in terms of encouraging them for sustainable secondary and specialty agriculture, to also disseminate knowledge to the farmers, provide technical backstopping, and develop new agribusiness models, and go in for entrepreneurship for value chain, not you know, advanced value chain, but the primary rural based value chain. Like if you are producing tomato and tomorrow in the market there is glut and there is no price available, why not make puri of it and store for some time and regulate your supply to see that both producer and consumer are benefited. Next one. So need for paradigm shift is there from narrow focus on youth as a farmer to youth as a value chain developer to harness better economic opportunities, and government to provide enabling policy environment for long-term investment, give them loan for long-term. We have recommended don't charge them interest for first 5 years. Give them loan at 4% interest rate, and make sure that they are provided support by either KVK or university or ICR institution, and also change agricultural education system in the schools as well as in universities, and go in for entrepreneurial program, not for the white collar job oriented degree program, but maybe for apprenticeship, like we had IITs and ITIs. These universities should also think in the context of ITIs now for future, to make sure that these youth, if they are interested in any kind of profession, are given that knowledge training for a shorter period, given a certificate, and then they are able to make a better living on it. And please go ahead. Next one. So in conclusion, I would like to say that our future challenge for food, nutrition, health and environmental security, I have not covered the SDG goals, which are covering all these. We need to reduce poverty. We need to see that there is no hunger, and we have to have better environment. We have to address climate change, and we have to reduce our load on use of fossil fuel. Thanks God, Rajasthan is ahead of other states in terms of solar energy generation. Even solar energy generation could be an option for our youth to provide low value electricity to the farmers for their tube wells, whereas electricity otherwise is costly. And it is the option there. The government has done very well, I must say, in the last 7-8 years, and at the national level we are much ahead than many other countries in the world. So solar energy generation, wind power energy generation, thinking of micro irrigation. Rajasthan again is ahead of others. When I convinced the Honorable Chief Minister, who is presently also the Chief Minister, that time when we brought in agriculture policy, he was the Chief Minister and desired us to suggest the options for saving water in agriculture. So that time when we proposed that let us go for micro irrigation and then flood irrigation in canal command areas of Indira Gandhi Canal, then it was found very difficult because farmers had already got used to cultivating not scientifically sustainable, but nothing could be done. They once saw water, they only thought of rice and wheat and cotton, so they grew. Today we have a lot of problems there of water logging, flooding and also salinity, but to say them not to go for flooding possibly is difficult. But then he took the idea and said that in Narmada Canal Command area, I will make sure that there is no flooding. So it is all micro irrigation. It is only example in the country today where micro irrigation of the canal command area has not only helped our state, but the area coverage has been almost doubled than what we had earlier thought of using the same model which we had otherwise thought of Indira Gandhi Canal. So we have to think of new approaches and we have to go in that direction. So the task ahead is no doubt difficult but not insurmountable provided there is needed policy support. No doubt we need policy support. And that's why our report to the government has talked about policy support, direct benefit support to the farmer, not on urea, but to the farmer on using fertilizer as per his need, based on soil testing. So if he needs gypsum, he must get that, and direct benefit transfer should go to him, rather than on urea to the producer. It should go to the farmer directly to his bank account, provided he has improved his agronomic practices and made it more efficient. It should go to him if he goes for conservation agriculture. He covers the field. He helps the nation to overcome the problem of soil and wind erosion and therefore reducing the greenhouse gas emissions to a considerable extent. But for that environmental service, he would need compensation. Compensation of the kind in the whole world people are getting for carbon sequestration. We should also, and that's what we have recommended, that farmers be given compensation to the extent of about 10,000 rupees per acre to the extent of maximum 4 acres per family, and that should be linked to the efficient agronomic practices. There are options, but we need to have a paradigm shift and think differently. Without change, there will be no growth. This is the last message I would like to give. And without change, we really cannot progress. But change is difficult. But change is must. And for that, we need to change our mindset. Change even of mindset of our farmers, because they don't allow youngsters to do something differently than what they have been doing themselves. They would say, no, you are talking out of your head. But I think that's the kind of mindset. We have to change mindset of our own policy makers, our even heads of departments. When we wanted to give powers for principal scientists, we found maximum reservation was that from the heads of the divisions. So it is not easy, but that doesn't mean we should not change. If we know, if there was not zeal, there would have been no growth, no movement, no progress. And therefore, if we don't change, we will not progress. So for bringing youth in place, we need to change our whole scenario in the context of not only training them, educating them, empowering them, and also to the extent of making them successful. But let me say, while concluding, don't get disheartened by failure. If you don't take risk, you will never succeed. And if you get disheartened by failure, you will then never be able to achieve the desired goal. And Dr. Abdul Kalam in my science congress had come and talked to the youth. We had organized youth congress at that time. We had just started youth congress in agriculture science congress. And he said that young people, you must dream, but dream big. Don't dream small. But when you dream big, then you must also work hard, because it is not intelligence alone. It is also the diligence and perseverance, which is the ladder of success. So with this I would like to say sky is the limit, and we need to motivate youth, for there is a responsibility for all stakeholders, not only of youth themselves. And no doubt we have to see that in future we think of a new agriculture, secondary agriculture, specialty agriculture, and linking ourselves to the market, to reduce the exploitation of farmers by middlemen in the market, and making sure that producer gets the right produce at the right price. Agriculture is itself a private sector. And only difference is that in private sector, whatever you produce, you decide the price of your produce. In agriculture, someone else decides our price. So how do we fight with this scenario and bring in some difference and change is the thing which we will ever also think of. And for that, we will require youth, and for that we will require trained youth who can be better entrepreneurs and also better capitalists in future. Thank you very much for this opportunity, Dr. Rathore. I appreciate your having asked me to do this, and nothing would give me more pleasure to have abided by your directive, because you are Honorable Vice Chancellor of the institution where I got trained.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for a nice coverage of the topic, and in fact you have given a complete encyclopedia of agriculture, starting from that from where we have started, how much we have acquired so far. You have appreciated the effort made by the scientists that since independent until date in the field of milk, we have crossed 188 million tons of milk production. In horticulture, we have already crossed 320 million tons, and in the fish, we have crossed 15 million tons. These are the some things through which our youngsters may get some insight that how they can develop a very good space in future as well. You have also complimented and congratulated our all scientists that as far as our world culture is concerned, and especially you have appreciated the effort made by the state government in our Rajasthan. And I will also endorse the same statement that Rajasthan fortunately has got a lot of ICR institute, and apart from that, we have made a complete decentralization of agriculture education or agriculture field. Now we have got a 5 state agriculture universities and 1 Rajivas, that is a veterinary university. And if you will see that if you will see the area wise, 61% of the area is in arid, and Bikaner and Jodhpur universities are taking care. As far as our semi-arid region is concerned, that is around 16% area. And fortunately, Dr. Sandhu, our Vice Chancellor of Jodhpur University, he has also addressed with us. I welcome Dr. Sandhu as well. And we have got one university exclusively in our arid region, in a sub-humid region, and one is in humid region. So fortunately, very good infrastructure facilities available. And for all participants, I would like to say that if you see that the way he has presented the things, he really deserves appreciation. At the initial inception, he paid a rich tribute to Maharana Pratap. And he purposely pointed out that let us see the self-confidence and taking risk at the each and every segment. If you see the history of Maharana Pratap, same thing is true with in present context as well. We should be a man, we should become a man of a determination, then only we will successful. And he ultimately said that there is a need for a change. And as far as the change is concerned, there is a need over that in case if you will change after change, you can survive, but if you will not change with change, you will definitely failure. But if you are responsible for change, you will become a leader. And that's why he urged that all youngsters and youth, especially from the rural area, that they should come forward and make a change. And there are a lot of reforms and refine and fine-tuning scope is available. And very systematically, sir, really, if you see that a complete, we have recorded it and we will broadcast further it to the different persons, those who have not got this opportunity to join here today. Because you have listed that we will have to think globally, but we will have to act locally, because there are a lot of good opportunity at local area is available. And how we can have a right type of things. And we may be fighting with a lot of a problem, but we will have to see that is our responsibility, our collaboration. Because COVID itself, it gives them a lot of impression. As far as if you see that spelling of COVID, and really I'm sorry, in between of there were some disturbance because many people were joining, and immediately our Dr. Naveen Chaudhary was on a line and he was muting this all newcomers, but even then there was some disturbance. I'm sorry, we will have to live with this, because if you see that C gives an impression, there are a lot of challenges, and in challenges in the field of our education, in the challenges in the field of even at the farmer front, if you see at initial inception of a very first 21 days of our lockdown, everything was standstill. Even we were harvesting the crop, most of the farmers, they were handicapped, how to do and how to harvest and then how to make it to the, how to sell it. There was a big challenge. So the same thing is true with our education institute. We have got a problem of connectivity. Although we know that a lot of digital solutions are available, but it's still, in order to perfect it, is as far as our requirement is concerned. Internet connectivity is a big issue for most of the villages. So C gives an impression that we will have to develop as far as the connectivity is concerned, and we will have to see that what are the different challenges in the agriculture. You have nicely elaborated there is a need to have a conservation agriculture, precision agriculture, high-tech cultivation, protected cultivation, even specialty agriculture, which is a need of our. I am really sorry to say that still we people are working in education field, but we fail to attend on this issue. And there is a big scope of improvement as far as even that your agriculture processing and marketing. You mentioned about ENAM. ENAM basically is one of the things. Perhaps you forget to mention one of the very important things which you have narrated earlier. When you were given a responsibility as a chairman of a evaluation of Krishi Vigyan Kendra, I still remember you have given a terminology so-called TADA CB, TADA CB. And everybody has to learn that what does exactly TADA CB is having a meaning. TADA CB means a technology assessment. When we are saying T means a technology, A means a assessment, and whenever there is assessment, a perfection and modification, everything come into the picture. Means every extension worker is supposed to work as a scientist and a research scientist, and in continuation he is supposed to make a demonstration. D means a demonstration, A means application, and CB means a capacity building. So in a youth, they can come forward, and you have given lot of good options that how improve seed production they can involve. There are more than 125 sub-sectors which the government of India is propagating, and in every sector our youth can identify. And as such, in our state, we have got 8 crore population. Out of this, only 1 crore population, especially rural youth staying in the rural villages, they have got some problem. Otherwise, fortunately, rest of the 1.5 crore youngsters in the city area, they more than 44 lakh people are having opportunity to go to the colleges. Fortunately, we have got 27 state-funded universities, and apart from this one, total 55 universities are there. As such, Government of India is proactively working to motivate and to mobilize these resources. And in fact, as you mentioned, youth is perhaps is a need of our, and in for future, if you want to change something, we will have to see. And there is a need to have to create a right type of awareness in the mindset of a youth so that they can see what are the different opportunities in agriculture field. We will have to awaken them, because many people are there, youngsters, they think that a white collar job will be case if it will be available by any means. They used to prefer, but basically we will have to articulate knowledge, skill, ability and experience in the right way so that these people can understand what is the importance of skill in our field. So there are a lot of good opportunities available. We will have to broaden our scope of work. You have mentioned, and this is a right lesson to for all scientists like us, that we should understand that how we can broaden our scope of work. Our work is not only confined to teach the student in the classroom and university, but we will have to expand our field even to the rural youth, those who are deprived of this facility. We should go to the unreached people and can extend the technology, that how they can converge the different types of technology, how they can explore the possibility of collaboration and cooperation, how a right type of documentation and dissemination technique we should adopt. So there are a lot of good challenges is there, and at this moment there is definitely we all are in the right platform. We have produced a lot of things, and as you mentioned, agriculture perhaps it is the largest private sector. But only thing is that some reform, policy support and reform is required so that the farmer will be in the position to decide its price. Perhaps this is one of the lacuna, and as a result of this, there is an unrest. But fortunately in Rajasthan, most of the villagers or farmers, they have got, apart from the land, although they have got a very small size land, but they have got an equal quantity of animals. And as a result of this, very little unrest is there. If you compare ourselves with Maharashtra and other one, the animal husbandry is quite supportive in this thing. And as you mentioned, there is a decline in the soil health. Recently, Dr. Ratan Lal ji, one of the eminent scientists who was from this land only, and has seen in the newspaper, he has nicely elaborated that as far as the microorganism is concerned, it should be 3%, but unfortunately in Rajasthan, it is hardly 0.1%. Same thing is true with our organic carbon. It should be around 0.8%, whereas it is hardly 0.3%. So we will have to do perhaps this all youngsters, in case if they will decide that how they can articulate the right way. You have mentioned there is a good scope of it, good agriculture practices, even if your agriculture processing and value addition, agriculture marketing, food safety and security as well. There are a lot of things is there, and this is my observation. Nowadays, in a post-COVID situation, people more are interested in a homemade food, and very less person now are interested to go to the hotel and restaurant. And even many people are coming forward to understand that what is the philosophy behind and what is the technology of vertical farming, as you mentioned. Vertical farming, hydroponic and aeroponic, because they want to grow their vegetable there in their field and in their house itself. So there is a good scope in future. We should understand that our field is not limited up to the farmer field, but our scope has got a very good opportunity. We can understand that how we can move, because in the world which is there in the COVID, it means a digital solution. And perhaps digital solution is the choice for increasing our production and productivity and even profitability in the agriculture field. Not only our artificial intelligence, machine learning and deep learning, but apart from this one, augmented reality, virtual reality, Internet of Things. I have seen nearby your office in the IERI itself, people have demonstrated nicely that how Internet of Things can be utilized for the purpose of predicting the vegetative growth and when to irrigate, how much to irrigate and fertile irrigation concept. There a lot of scope is there. Only thing is that we will have to motivate the youngsters. This is big challenge. And you have nicely narrated that this is a responsibility of all teachers and scientists working in agriculture industry and agriculture institute. They should draw some strategy, and so that they can motivate. First of all, it is a motivation. In case if we will be definite, if we will motivate the youngsters, there is a good opportunity available nicely. SWOT analysis, complete SWOT analysis we have listed, and we will prepare one of my friends, Dr. Virendra Nepalia, OSD to our Vice Chancellor Secretary. He has taken the complete note and which we will try to compile, and then we will circulate to the different university as well. So I won't take much more of the time, but as you mentioned that youth, there is a need to convert the youth into a value chain developer, not a youth as a farmer. I many times see that many senior people, they are asking us that as a scientist in the agriculture field, how many students you have converted into the farmer? That is a big question. Nobody wants to become a farmer, but as far as a value chain developer is concerned, because already we have reached to the highest level, second highest level. In a milk, we are in the first position. In the fruits and vegetables, we are second position. Right, you are right. You mentioned that we reached to the 118 million tons. As far as the wheat is concerned, we reached to the 106 million tons. So there is a considerable amount of food production is there. Only thing is that we should mobilize this youth into the value chain developer. Then only things will be that in a right way, because this is a young India where a lot of people below the 30 years, they are having a, they are searching some job, and perhaps agriculture is a good field where they can develop mechanization to certain extent. I also feel if we have got a very good poor position as far as the mechanization in Rajasthan is concerned. Rajasthan, we have got Aravali range where most of the people, Hillock people are living. So we don't have a right mechanization for the hilly area. Second problem is the mechanization for a small and marginal farmer having 0.5 hectare and 0.6 hectare land. How to see that he will afford the tractor and other high cost machinery? For that, this custom hiring is a good option. So we have also taken this in on a larger scale in an adopted village. Sir, here I would like to mention, our Rajbhavan has directed us that you should do some innovative things. And as a result of this, what we have done, not only innovation in the field, but they have given that some directives that let us adopt two villages, at least two villages. And after every 2 years, you are supposed to shift to different village. And where you can converge all different type of technology. You will have to explore the possibility that how you can do a right type of collaboration and cooperation with a sponsoring agency and financing institute, and how you can do collective action as far as the development, not only in agriculture development, but rural development. Even in the field of education, if there in that village some school is available, how we can do a right renting as far as the education to small kids and children are concerned. And even we are supposed to do some activity as far as the capacity development is concerned. I am really happy to share with the all of you, and especially to our Paroda sir, that is our both of village which we have identified in a tribal belt, everybody has appreciated, including our honorable governor sir. He purposely said, and even our secretary Raj Bhavan, he has also included in his presentation that what type of a new innovative things we have made. Here there is a good opportunity. The villagers or youngsters from that village itself, they can come forward. We have demonstrated one farmer, one youngster, who was moving here and there in Udaipur to search of a job. Then we have trained him, and today he is having a motorcycle repair shop in village itself. That type of good opportunity is available. We will have to think that how we can mobilize them. And this is a big task, and there is a need to have a systematic approach on this aspect. We are definitely, we will try to fulfill whatever you have mentioned. You have given a very good directives and how we can motivate the youngsters. But at this moment, we can assure you that we will try to articulate this thing in our day-to-day activity, and we will try to convey this message to all our students. So that these are the different opportunities. So I take this, I take this opportunity to welcome from my inner core of my heart, and really I am elevated myself and feeling that such a big dignity without any, he accepted our proposal and he came forward in spite of fact that during your presentation even you faced a lot of it. A problem because of ECO and because of this. Because everybody, it is not because we have got some party arrangement, but everybody is so keen to listen to you. You won't believe, sir, still, when you were presenting, I was getting a lot of messages on my WhatsApp group that they kindly allow us to get an entry. So we have decided, and immediately I am writing that we are going to compile each and everything in a reported form, and we will try to supply it to all of you. So at last, once again, thank you very much. Thank you a lot for sparing your valuable time, and we will seek this type of guidance in future as well. And I am equally grateful to my all honorable Vice Chancellor. I was told that a Vice Chancellor from Dharwad University, Dr. Chetty, has also joined. Dr. Parveen Roy, you won't believe, sir, from last evening, he was trying best to join this. And everybody, even Dr. Sandhu has joined. Other my Vice Chancellor from Pota, he has also joined. So now everybody is looking, and we are basically fortunate that such a person is from our piece of land from Rajasthan and giving a direction. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot to you, sir. Thank you very much. Now I will, for a formal vote of thanks, I will invite Dr. S.K. Sharma. I take also this opportunity to convey my sincere thanks to all organizers. Here I am really grateful to Dr. Nepalia. He is the OSD, of course. obviously to the Vice Chancellor Secretary. But sir, I have seen he is a so nice person and always doing all academic exercise. You must be knowing Vice Chancellor hardly gets some time for academic job. But he is a person who is supporting me. Dr. Naveen Chaudhary, he is a professor of computer science. And you won't believe, sir, a person of determination, and he is a person who is having always keeping elevation at low level, and whatever responsibility you assign, he is always proactively accepting. Same thing is true with Dr. S.K. Sharma, our General Director of Research, and Dr. Manjeet Singh, he is also Assistant Professor in 12 Water Conservation Engineering. So all people, they have nicely done, and of course our Student Welfare Officer who has done this all activity and try to mobilize our scholar especially to join this your talk. I also place and record his contribution making this program as a success. And at last, for a formal vote of thanks, I invite Dr. S.K. Sharma, is a non-journal director research of in our university. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Great privilege for me to extend my vote of thanks on behalf of the MPUT.